this word. No, this is actually the bridge between the word hope and the word open. But it's actually ho of ho ho ho. It's the hop from hip hop, and it's pen, and it's en of English. So my question for you is, how open are you? We think that just because we are aware of all the ideas circulating around us that we are open. We're not. You think that just because you have learned to open yourself to your insight and meditate that you are open? Not yet. Because to be really open, you need to use your body as the instrument to materialize your ideas. And slowly, you put your ego on the side and you reach absolute flow. This is the Convent de Mafra. For those of you who haven't been there, it's the greatest piece of Baroque architecture we have in Portugal. And there's three lessons to be learned from here. First, it was not designed by an architect. It was designed by a jewelry maker, Frederic Ludovic. Second, on the left you have the King's Palace, on the right the Queen's Palace, and where would they meet? In the church, in the center. And third, and my favorite, this library conserves some of the oldest books in Portugal, and it was part of the architecture strategy to allow bats to come inside the library to eat the bugs that eat the books. This bat family has been living there for over 250 years, and they eat the insects that eat the books. And it's the perfect example of equilibrium between the human being and nature. This drawing is called a Lorentz attractor. It represents the chaos theory, or as some of you might like to call it, the butterfly effect. And what's so beautiful about this is that it's about the eternal flow between positive and negative. We live in a society that doesn't let us be negative. You have to be positive. You have to be smiling all the time. But is that natural? It seems to me that the negative is a space of inevitable growth. The society of the 20th century, the positive and negative, bipolarity, you are very sweet at home and you're a devil at work. Or you're a devil at home and you're an angel at work, you know. And the further the connections, the stronger the connections between positive and negative, the stronger the core. And the more harmony and equilibrium and balance you will have. This is the Mayan symbol of the Aquarius era, which is a constant oscillation between positive and negative. When you get high, you don't get so high. When you get low, you don't get so low. Okay? If there's an argument between a man and a woman, it's not the man that is right or the woman that is wrong. We're now aware that one needs to understand what led the other person to act the way he or she did. It's another... We're getting there. The left and the right side of the brain, the emotional and the rational, connected by a very thin bridge. The internet map, mapped by one single computer by the course of one day. And it's very beautiful because this shows the hierarchy of the internet, which is basically not a pyramidal structure, but a structure of intervention. If you intervene, if you participate, you exist. If you don't participate, you don't exist. In other words, the word we is the evolution of the word me. This is 1946 Buckminster Fuller's map of the world. It's called the dimension map. What he did was he made an origami globe of planet Earth and he unfolded it to realize that in fact we are one continent and one ocean. and we are all very much connected. From the 70s, from our friend and guru, Jonah Friedman, Continent City, and this is how Europe would look like if we were a network of self-sufficiency, a network of self-help, balancing wealth and wisdom, not a brand. This is what would happen if Sweden was connected, and this is where I'm going to focus right now for the next couple of minutes, the region of Stockholm. This is the region of Stockholm, year 1802. So 200 years ago, everything was farmland except that black dot in the center, that's urban. And 200 years later, 2011, exactly at the same scale, in white water, in gray land, and in black urban. And this is known to be one of the most segregated cities in the world, okay? People are very lonely, and they live very far away from each other. And they are dependent on car to go everywhere. So if we do nothing, or if people don't intervene in the current master plan for the region, the government will continue to allow investors and builders to plant more segregated suburbs away from each other and contribute to oil dependency and loneliness and fear. So what we are proposing to the Swedish people and the Swedish government is to actually frame the future growth of the city onto urban or onto bridge villages that connect the currently disconnected suburbs. And in between the bridge villages, we can have urban agriculture courtyards that will enable neighbors to meet planting, growing their food, and bringing that food home. So it's a strategy for self-sufficiency of the region of Stockholm. For those of you who didn't understand anything of what I said, if Stockholm was a Dalmatian dog, what we are doing is connect the dots. This is our performance in the Architecture Museum of Sweden, and one of the things we realize is that the same way there are celestial constellations, there are urban constellations as well. The stars are already here, they just need to be connected. This is the plan of neurons connecting, and I would like to quote Krishnamurti, "There are no leaders, you are your own leader. There are no followers, you are your own follower." Artist Antonio Martinho from Proença Velha spends his time portraiting wisdom keepers, people who never had social support, people who never had antibiotics. They help each other, they plant their own, they grow their own, they have their own remedies. And if you ask me, they are the true keepers of Portuguese culture. These people are disappearing. And if you ask them if they prefer to be where they are, or in an elderly home somewhere, they will prefer to be where they have always been. So, coming back to Stockholm, this is all the bridge villages, from 5 kilometers to 200 meters, organized by size. And this is a typical bridge village connecting the positive and the negative suburb A and suburb B. It goes around rocks, forests, and water, okay? Because we need to respect nature. No burning forests to build, that's ridiculous, you know? So this is a map of old Rome by Piranesi. What we did is we pasted the old map inside of a bridge village to show you that it doesn't matter which sort of architecture it's built. What's most necessary is that people are connected, okay? And like we did in India, this is an image from India, just a quick reference, we ask the people what they want and we interpret what they want into architecture. So the architect is the processor of public opinion rather than a dictator of tasty ideas, okay? Back to Stockholm, we calculated a self-sufficiency ratio with the transition movement and the SLU, the local university of agriculture, and 1 hectare is enough for 4 people to be self-sufficient. So if we grab the density of Tokyo, so low-rise, 3-4 stories, and high human density, and we paste that density into all proposed bridge villages, we have a self-sufficiency ratio of 28%. But if we go forward and if we use a local density, like Solheim, like this one, and we do the same exercise, Stockholm can actually be 119% self-sufficient, meaning people don't have to go to work, they can go plant their own crops, they can be self-sufficient and can export 19%, and with the profit of that 19%, you can pay your debt and live happily ever after. So this is the drawing that shows all the bridge villages that we proposed. It's a 200-year master plan. And we would like to build the first bridge village with least effort as possible. So this is the project that we are now working with, which is to use an old bridge that connects Lidingö to Stockholm and to use it for housing and etc. I came back to Portugal after this, and I showed this project connecting Stockholm, this self-sufficiency strategy, to Dr. Ribeiro Teles. He's a guru in landscape architecture. And he said, well, Filipe, this is great. Why don't you do one of these in Portugal? I said, great. So I started looking around, and I looked at the hortas urbanas. They are illegal, but somehow they're very interesting because there's so many. You know, it's really happening here. Hortas urbanas everywhere, and this man alone was growing everything from tomatoes, beans, corn, sugar cane. I mean, everything I could possibly imagine. Sweet potato alone, and he said, "Well, the poor man has to eat. We don't have money. We have to eat." So, and this one, Mr. Pedro, actually invited me, showed me around, gave me a pumpkin. And for a poor man to give me a pumpkin, it means that he had a lot of pumpkins, you know. And this is in the middle of the city. So, are we really that desperate? I mean, maybe we are stepping on top of our own treasure, you know. So, I kept on thinking, and I went all the way to Dom Dinis. And his amazing law of Six Marias. Anybody knows latest Six Marias? It's 1375. It's like 700 years ago. He allowed ordinary people to go to the countryside and use and farm any land that is left alone. You wouldn't own the land, you can't build there, and you have to give 10% of your crops to the landlord, but you can actually go and do something. So what we want to do next is called EASP, Estratégia de Autossuficiência Alimentar para Portugal. And we want to follow Dom Dinis here, resurrect his spirit or something. But we want to go beyond thinking. We wanted to create an instrument, a social instrument, to actually start implementing these visions in real time, in real places. And we don't want to go agriculture only, we want to go beyond farming, we want to go fishing. So we went to Cova do Vapor, which is the first bridge of Costa da Caparica. And it's such a beautiful story, because before, that little village over there would stretch all the way to that lighthouse, but as the sea level was rising and people really, really liked living there, they got cows and bulls and lifted the houses and brought the houses back home. And they are still there today, 80 years later. And they live from fish. It's beautiful, you know. You have the tastiest fish in the world. So we founded the Informal School of Architecture, TISA. And we spent 3 months on site getting to know the people, measuring every house, making miniature models of every house, and most important than everything, writing the story of every house. You have no idea how incredible the stories are. So architecture as an evidence of human behavior, of negotiation, of communication. Architecture that is alive, you know. Last week, a man that had a blue house paints the house yellow because he feels like it, you know. What do you want me to say? It's like changing your haircut. You know, it's beautiful, you know? And after doing all those models and lots of streaming, we actually put all the models together and we made, in Cova do Vapor, the biggest party they have in the last 50 years. This community is the teacher. And every village should from now on be seen or called by us as schools of self-sufficiency, universities of self-sufficiency. This urban village in focus right now got together to build houses, they got together to get the electricity, they got together to bring water, and right now they all saved money together to put a road without asking anybody anything. They did it. They're an example. They're on the move. They're doing it. And we're watching, complaining. You know, we have to do it, you know. It's never going to be perfect. So what? It's going to be. Let's do it, you know. And this is the a fraction of the list of everybody that's contributed. If you have 50 euros, you give 50. You have 10, you give 10. You have 500, give 500. But you give something. You're part of the change, okay? I would like to finalize this with two sentences. First, we need your help to continue these strategies for collective evolution. And I would like to quote one of our greatest gurus, Mr. Buckminster Fuller. You never change something by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. Thank you very much. If you look on your left, far beyond the silo, that's covered with vapor there. That's where they're building the road. That's where they're fixing the houses. Maybe the guy who painted the house blue has painted it red now, I don't know. But it's alive, and please go visit, discover your country, engage, and let's go towards collective evolution. Thank you again.